Diamond V Sports presents... The American Sports Cavalcade. A panorama of speed, color, drama, and excitement. The American Sports Cavalcade.
They're alcohol-blowing multi-engine tractors, the 7,200-pound big boys. And we'll be seeing them today along with their little brothers, the 6,200-pound two-wheel drive trucks. From the Astrodome in Houston, Texas. Hello, I'm Paul Page, and welcome to Houston, Texas. Now, when I think of Texas, I think of two things. First of all, Texas oil. And secondly, is TNN's annual visit to the Astrodome for the TNT Super Nationals. Now, I've already shown you two of the tractor pulling classes that we're going to be enjoying today, but there's also the monster trucks. And for an update on that excitement, let's go inside the Astrodome to my colleague, Steve Evans.
As you well know, Paul, crushing cars has always been a very important part of monster truck competition. And as always, I've come down to the field of the Astrodome to make sure that one of these 42 cars didn't get in here by mistake. Maybe a classic like that little Mercedes last year. I'm happy to report this year, they all deserve to die. I mean, these are some ugly machines, all gas guzzlers from the 70s and 80s. Nobody is going to miss them. What's kind of funny, though, and a little prophetic, is some of the sayings and bumper stickers applied long before they knew their ultimate fate. Now, that should have been on the roof. Now, here's one I particularly like on a particularly ugly Robin's Egg Blue Continental. Owner replied, "If you touch him, my car, I break your face." From the looks of it, he had a lot of takers on that one. And here's a beauty that at least at one time was a winner back in the election year of 1988. Now, to tell us a bit more about the machines that would be doing the crushing just outside the Astrodome, here's our pal, Pat Patterson.
Well, Steve, never in my racing career have I ever seen anything like the monster trucks that'll compete in the Astrodome. This is your basic Ford variety here. It's about 1,000 horsepower. It's alcohol-injected and about 13,000 pounds. It takes about a 5-foot tractor tire to keep it moving up and down the racetrack. This is your basic Chevrolet version here of a Chevy S10, perhaps only about a third of the width of the body of the normal ones that move up and down the streets and byways of these United States. And another Chevrolet variety here, Nightlife 2, a little more standard body style, and certainly the same horsepower and basically the same weight as all the other trucks. Now, something very interesting about all of these crews is they all work very closely with each other. Families travel together. They race with each other all year long. But you can bet one thing. When the green light comes on in the Astrodome, these guys are out to get themselves a big win at one of the biggest events, the TNT Super Nationals in the Astrodome. It'll be no holes barred, take no prisoners. These guys are out to win. It's great to be with you and Paul Page, and we're looking forward to it right here on TNN.
Well, thanks, Pat. We'll be seeing the monster trucks a little later on, and we, too, can't wait. Right now, here's the heavy metal ball bait, 7,200-pound modified tractors, and they pack more than one motor, more than two motors, sometimes as many as four motors.
We got a glimpse there of Fred Freeman. The machine is the mean mistreater, and it looked like at the last second they made an adjustment to the front. Yeah, they're going to pull some weights around and make some changes here. Now he's ready to go. I love these machines. Look at that. Motors plugged in on all sides of the thing. Well, we're talking about power. Just take a look there.
Oh, boy. Maybe they don't have a lot of forward speed, but the power it takes to pull a sled that can weigh up to 60,000 pounds is just incredible. I wonder sometimes with all the motors if they even know if one of them isn't running.
Well, I'll tell you what. They are loud enough, and they develop an incredible amount of horsepower. And before you start laughing too much at the engines plugged in at the side and two in line in the front, think of what type of mechanical engineering work it takes to get all of those things to meet at a common shaft together.
Absolutely. This is Fred Freeman, Wadsville, Indiana. There you see the hook process. That's what they call it, to hook to the sled. Here's the emergency device that would kill all the engines should the tractors somehow get loose from the sled. Now, the full pull distance, the ideal pull, is 300 feet here in the Astrodome.
All right, this is Fred Freeman. This session, and he started back. to a stop.
And one of those engines wasn't running very well. We can see the blow-by out the bottom of the Mean Miss Breeder. The distance comes in 254.83 feet. It's that precise because it's measured with a laser beam.
So that's the benchmark. With the first run, that's what everybody else will shoot at. Now take a look at the front end here. He wanted to come off the line and come a little bit to the right. Every time the front wheels hit the ground, he tries to steer it a little bit, but it got bouncing just a little too much. That meant the weight didn't transfer nearly as well as he would have liked. And so I think he's going to be a little bit disappointed with this run. The 7,200-pound modified tractor class, Fred Freeman, the Mean Miss Streeter, the first run in this category. Now he's down at the far end with Pat Patterson. Pat?
Fred, what kind of pass was it for you?
Well, I really don't think it was a very good pass. I was first hook. I had the option to drop it for no more money than it's worth. It wasn't worth another run on my engine.
We'll see if it stands up.
Yeah, I don't think it'll be any good, but it'll be good enough for the top five.
The first puller is called the test puller, and he has the option of dropping back three in line and pulling again if he elects to do that. Apparently, Fred Freeman elects not to do that, and he's going to stick with his 254 feet and change.
Well, I think Fred realizes that they've really done a nice job of grooming this track here in the Houston Astrodome. This is the Texas Flash. That's Donald Nelson up in the seat, and again, we're talking motors, motors, and more motors. Look at that. Two behind one another, and then one up and behind that.
I'll tell you, these machines are a machinist's dream, or a nightmare, depending on how you look at it, because almost all of the drive boxes and gearboxes are handmade.
Yeah, it's real pretty until you have to climb in there with a wrench and fix it. Now, you saw Donald Nelson hold his hands up. They have to do that by the rules anytime somebody's working at the back of the machine, so everyone's assured that he doesn't reach down at the last second and adjust something. As soon as the tractor is hooked, then everybody steps out of the way and we're ready to go.
Well, Donald is from that well-known Texas metropolis of Cat Springs.
Oh, yeah, I've had dinner there up in their high-rise. Really a nice thing.
Yeah, the revolving restaurant. Yeah, I've been there. He's got the hammer. Oh, the front end may have come up a little early. He, too, may have missed the balance here. Plus, he's drifting off to the left.
I think he's going to wish he had a little more weight on the front end. Surprisingly enough, Fred Freeman's run holds up because Donald Nelson comes in a distant second right now at 241.2 feet. So Freeman, with his run, the first run of the day, is still in first place.
And there you see the butterflies and the fuel injection of our next competitor ready to fire. We'll be right back for that pull. Stay with us in the Houston Astrodome.
Welcome back to the TNT Super Nationals from the Astrodome in Houston, Texas. I'm Paul Page with Steve Evans, and take a look at them. Engines plugged in all over the place here. You're looking at the fancy farmer, and the man driving the fancy farmer himself is Robert Elliott.
And Robert Elliott has a brand new tractor. The one he formerly competed in was destroyed in shipment coming back from Europe after some exhibition. So this is the maiden voyage, as it were, of the brand new fancy farmer, and it may be a little nose heavy.
And we saw the opposite of this in the last run where the nose was too light. I think he's got way too much weight on the front end of this one because he comes up at 199 feet. And I'll bet you that right now, Fred Freeman is scratching his head saying, what am I doing still in first place after three runs? Freeman has the top pull, followed by Donald Nelson. This one slides into third.
And here's our next puller, Brian Armistead in the Dollar Devil. Armistead is from Lancaster, England, where this sport is growing, in fact, in France and in England.
Yeah, it's growing in popularity around the world, Steve. Robert Elliott has now pulled off the helmet and is with Pat.
Robert, I know that's a brand new tractor. You only had just a little bit of time with it. You actually had one of your tractors destroyed being shipped back from Europe, and so you really weren't testing this one out tonight.
Yeah, it's been quite difficult. This tractor's been giving us a little problem, but we're not going to give up on it. We've had a lot of problems getting the balance. We changed the engines up from the other one, the configuration, and We've had a little bit of engine problem. We got a corrosion in there and that salt water. Thank you. All right.
Those must be the engines out of the damaged tractor that must have been brought across the pond on the deck of the ship to get saltwater corrosion. Well, finally, the Englishman, Brian Arnestad, has got all of those engines fired up. That takes a while when you got this many. And he is ready to pull.
He looks back to make sure everybody's clear. He's shooting at a distance of 254 feet.
You know, Paul, it doesn't sound real good. The dollar double sounds like about 85 cents.
That many engines, it ought to just be cackling with power. We're not hearing it still. They're going to clear him for the run, but I'm sure that he is worried about the noises that he is hearing flow back over him from those motors.
But he doesn't pussyfoot around, boy. He goes hammered down on all four motors. Oh, the front end starts to come up, and that could be because it is down on power. Is it driving hard enough to push him down? But it's not all that bad. 213.89 feet will put him in the third position.
Again, any time that you are running down a straight line and drift off like he did, well, that cost you drastically. We take a look here. He got the front end up early and then got it back down on the ground a couple times, and that got it to bouncing a little bit. When you bounce, you start losing control.
Yep, you sure do. And these tractors are a lot harder to drive than people might think, even though they go in a straight line at only about 30 or 40 miles an hour. It takes tremendous finesse. Let's go to Pat Patterson. He's with our guest from England.
Well, Brian, you're our only Englishman in the show tonight. How was it in the Astrodome?
Oh, great. Never seen anything like it.
Tell me about the track and tell me about that pull for him.
Yeah, well, it was only the second pull I've ever had with it. But it, we're getting a little bit better, just getting used to it.
What about tractor pulling in England? I mean, can this go over as big in England as it is here in the States?
No, it's nowhere near as big yet, but we're trying to get there.
We're glad to have you.
Thank you.
Nice accent. Good to hear that kind of an accent, though a little strange when you're talking a sport like tractor pull. Back at the head of the line now, Mike Piper. The machine is just add dirt. His hands up to show that he's off the controls. It's safe to get in behind the tractor. These 7,200-pound multi-engine monsters, they're great.
That's Barbara, his wife, who does an awful lot of the work on this tractor. In fact, she is the crew. They're from Mount Vernon, Illinois, and right now, Barbara is anxiously awaiting the results of what could make them a heck of a lot of money to get on down the road to the next pull. So many of these teams are full-time pullers. At one time, they were no doubt farmers somewhere across the country and kind of gradually started pulling part-time, and many now have sold the old farm and live in their motorhome and truck these things across the country.
You know, I'm surprised, as I think many of the competitors are here, that we haven't seen a full pull. In fact, not anything near it.
The track is heavy. Most of the pullers have underestimated its ability. Not Mike Piper. This is a nice pull. Barbara says no, but it really looks pretty good from our angle. Just add dirt. Pulls 223.04 feet. Though I wonder what it takes to satisfy her.
Well, I think she was looking for a first place, and that 223 feet, that's just not sufficient for Mike Piper. As they unhook him, oh, she's upset with it. I wonder if she thinks that he actually did something wrong or if she made a misjudgment. He's not pleased either.
Those things that look like a bread pan go over all of the exhaust headers while the engine is still warm to keep it from bending valves. Let's take a look at what made Barbara so distressful.
Well, he never really got the run going the way they would have expected. The engines aren't running as smooth as they would have liked, and the weight didn't transfer. That front end should be up and riding a little bit better by right now, and it just never happened for him, and so the particularly short run. Barbara and Mike both disappointed with that.
Mike, tell me about that particular pull. Looked like your wheel speed was good off the line, but it just started bogging down on you a little bit about halfway down the pass.
Well, it wasn't so much bogging down. When we run a four-motor combination like this, we only run three motors. You can't get enough tire speed with three motors. The front end was terribly heavy. Couldn't get the lift out of the tractor. You just wouldn't set the track and hook up and run like it ought to.
So when you enter a three-motor tractor in the 7,200-pound class, you know all those things are a given. Had he got the weight right, he might have placed higher up on the money, but you're probably not going to win with a three-motor tractor in this category. Here is one of the most beautifully engineered and best-appearing tractors in all of TNT pulling. This is Dave Walsh of the Irish Challenger.
He's got a nice run going for him. He really laid into the power at the start, got the front end balanced pretty well. Pretty good
good pull for the Challenger.
You're darn right it is. 241.3 feet, and let's see, that will put him in second spot.
Still, I'm surprised as, you know, Dave doesn't seem too pleased with that. And I'm really surprised that we're not seeing some greater distances. I know Fred Freeman, who you remember at the start, said, I don't think that'll stand up at all. Well, he's still the leader.
Yeah, he said, I don't think it'll be better than fifth. And this was a pretty pull as far as it went. Maybe just a lack of power or whatever, but the front end was transferring nicely. Notice he's got the wheels cocked to the right so that when it lands, it heads in the right direction. Dave Walsh is with Pat at the end.
Well, Dave, tell me about that pass.
Well, the track's getting worse. So I think I was a little bit heavy up front. I could have used more weight in the rear.
As far as his wheel speed, you feel like you had the right wheel speed coming off? Did you have the right pressure in the tires?
Yeah, I think so. But, you know, these new limits, they give these guys four engines, and they got more wheel speed than I do. So it ain't really fair to run four against three.
Well, Dave Walsh, like Mike Piper, feels the three-engine tractors in this class are the underdogs, and maybe they are. On top of the standings so far, there's more to come, is a rather pleasantly surprised Fred Freeman at 254 feet, Dave Walsh at 241, Don Nelson 241, Piper at 223, and Brian Armistead, the Englishman, at 213. Well, there's going to be a great big change of pace here in just a few moments in the Astrodome as the first pair of monster trucks roll out. Stay with us at the TNT Super Nationals. These things are something to see.
We're back at the Houston Astrodome as we join the second round of competition in monster trucks. You may recognize the Awesome Kong, won here last year. And Awesome Kong here in round two will be up against Bigfoot. Now, everybody that's ever seen a monster truck show knows that Bigfoot is definitely the power to beat. And every year they do developmental work on it. Earlier, Steve took a look at the changes for this year.
If you're looking for new technology in monster trucks, all you have to do is stop by the Bigfoot pits here at the Astrodome or anywhere else, because Bob Chandler and his guys are always on top of it. Let me show you a brand new rear suspension. Gone is the typical coil-wrapped gas shocks, about 25 of them on the rear that sit straight up and down. This is cantilevered suspension, some technology borrowed from Baja Racing and Stadium Off-Road Racing. Look at these giant reservoirs. These are nitrogen over oil shock absorbers. Now, without springs, what do you do about the rebound? Well, you employ this tremendous torsion bar. Now, what has all this done for the handling of the truck? Well, it used to have 11 inches of up and down rear travel. It now has 24. It's got to be better.
So they've more than doubled the rear suspension travel. And the driver of the Bigfoot, Andy Brass, as he is on the line, ready to face Steve Kane in the Awesome Kong.
Anytime Steve Kane races Bigfoot, he gives it absolutely everything he's got and maybe 10% more. And I can tell you, Andy Brass knows that. I don't think it's a personal thing. Bigfoot has the big reputation. The more you can beat it, the more your reputation grows.
Interesting matchup here in round number two. Two of the top powers in the sport of monster truck racing. And Bigfoot lays the power over 1,000 horsepower and gets a head start over Awesome Kong. But Awesome Kong comes back with some speed. They come to the turn. Bigfoot nearly gets upside down and stops on the jump as Awesome Kong now is heading home and going to pick up the win.
I think Andy Brass knew he had cut that too tight and might be disqualified. So he backed it up and flies it to the line in legal fashion. But the loser, apparently.
Well, Bigfoot did cut that corner early, but then backed up and tried to get a good run at it. Here we can take a real good look and see exactly what happened. Bigfoot on the left starts to make the turn early on. Awesome Kong is coming a little bit wide. So while Bigfoot's turning early, take a look at the left front of Awesome Kong as it takes out that pylon. As a result of that, both are disqualified. Now Pat is with Andy Brass.
Well, Andy, you're out of of it at the Astrodome tonight, but you still think you might have won that race.
Yeah, it was. You know, it was a controversial race. They said both of us were disqualified, but down at the end down there, I seen I was going to hit the cone, so I had to back up, try to make a legal run. It's just something that we've been taught that, you know, there's always a chance the other guy making a DQ too, so you got to back up and just make a legal one.
Well, the fans sure love you here in the Astrodome, and I know that's a tough break for you and a tough one for the crowd.
Yes, it is a tough break. You know, like I said, I'd like to try to take it all tonight, you know, and I'd like the fans to see me do it with the new truck.
Thank you.
Well, Pat, maybe the jury isn't quite in yet on that. There's still some discussion going on among the officials. Well, here's one half of our next pair in round number two of Monster Truck Competition. The very strong King Crunch, driven by Scott Stevens, highly regarded in this sport, is having an awful lot of horsepower at every event. Right now, let's go back down and check in with Pat and Steve King.
Steven, a tough break for you and your truck tonight. Tell us what happened.
Well, I don't know. They said I hit the cones down there, but I talked to a few other people, and they said I didn't hit them, so I don't know what's going on.
Could any of your team see it, or, I mean, did anybody actually close enough down there to take a look at it for you?
No, everybody's got to stand way back, you know, so they can't really see what's going on down at the other end of the arena.
Well, it's a tough break. I know you want to do well.
Thank you.
Well, it's pretty clear on that camera down at the end there. He definitely came across the line and got the cone. So Steve Kane is disqualified as well. Well, here's the second truck of our next pair. It's the Equalizer, and it's driven by this man, David Morris. Of course, he is up to face Scott Stevens in the King Crunch, one of the prettiest monster trucks that's here at the Astrodome.
I'll tell you anymore, there are no ugly trucks in this business. The Equalizer out of Tennessee, King Crunch out of the state of Texas. Who got the advantage? It's over on the far side, the Equalizer.
Big bounce out of the King Crunch, and that slows him down coming into the corner. He's got to be real careful climbing that hill. Equalizer has a good lead now as he goes to the final run over the car. Equalizer takes the win.
What a beautiful turn at the far end by David Morris of Springfield, Tennessee. He used that four-wheel steering to perfection, and that's really where he won it. Brooke, watch this. Every driver here should watch this.
Yeah, he just came around that corner perfectly. You see how those four-wheel steering arrangements are aligned, straightened up, came off well, while at the same time, the King Crunch is all crossed up.
Yeah, that was just a beautiful drive. Certainly, David Morris earned his way into the semifinals with this high-flying Equalizer.
You get an idea there of how messed up the King Crunch was as he came almost sideways behind the Equalizer and took a whale of a bounce. So it's a situation of really excellent driving. Pat is with David Morris.
Well, Dave Morris, you look good on that pass.
Yeah, that felt like it's been my best one here since I've been in Houston. I just hope I can make a few more just like it.
You still feel comfortable down there in the turn? You look like you got around pretty quick that time, coming back this way.
Yeah, it's getting better. Being this is just my first turning course, everything's a little spooky, so I'm just taking it a little bit at a time, hoping to get better each time.
We advance to the next round. Good luck.
Thanks.
Well, his driving ability is incredible considering this is his first turning course, he said, Paul Page. A lot of the outdoor courses, affairs, is over the whole straight line. We'll come back with more of the 7,200-pound tractor class right after this.
We're back at the TNT Super Nationals from the Houston Astrodome. The 7,200-pound modified tractors, rear-wheel drive, and on this baby, we're talking four big engines plugged in. It's the Bandit, and that's Dave Banter up on top. Now, everybody has a different approach to how they hang the weights on their tractor. And earlier, Steve took a look at Dave Banter's particular philosophy.
A year ago, here at this very dome, we were privileged to show you the debut appearance of the radical Banter Brothers offset driver tractor. It was not only the beginning for that machine, it was the end. Dave Banter said they never got the weight balance right with that one engine sitting up high over the rear axle, and weight balance is everything in this sport. So the new Banter Brothers tractor, far more conventional and with very small front wheels, and that's so they can move the engine mass further forward. The problem is this. Their chassis are so good now, they're getting such traction and bite that it wants to carry the front end way too high. And rather than weight it down with lead, why not put the engines out there and put the lead where you need it? For example, outdoors in this class, 7,200 pound, he runs five engines. Indoors, TNT says, four is max. So the fifth engine that normally would go here has been pulled out. And how do you solve the case of the missing motor? Well, you have to come back here. Now, let's remember, you've taken more weight off of the rear end, taking out that rear engine. So Dave has to rethink it all and load more weight here, these 100-pound suitcase weights, on the rear for this indoor track, because he's got a lower gear with only four motors.
So the power begins to roar in four giant Chevrolet 454 engines. Look at those giant blowers up on top. You think Dave Banderin making a lot of power with the Bandit. He's taking a shot at a distance of 254 feet, and the power's already there. Off, he's gone. Good ride.
Oh, yes, absolutely brilliant. Banner hit the weight just about right on. Maybe a little nose heavy. Maybe those engines are a little too far out front. Let's wait for the measurement, and we've got it. 251.35 feet. That will put him in second place, and Fred Freeman continues to hang on to the lead, to his own amazement.
Yeah, I think Fred's more surprised than everybody else here. The engines are shut down now. A little exhaust vapor fire going there. We take a look again. You'll get an idea as he comes to the end of the run. You saw how much dirt he dug up. That gives you an idea of the incredible power that they're generating here. The balance is nice. The front end hanging, oh, maybe a little bit lower than they wanted, but nevertheless, looking pretty good. The run is far at 251.3 feet, but not necessarily good enough to take top place. Pat?
How was the track?
Oh, it's a good track, good sled setting and everything. It's good pole.
One of the great gentlemen in this sport, Dave Banner, along with his brother Ralph. They're in the second position, and our leader could be in trouble. Anytime you see that intense set of eyes, it is John Heilman, Team Heilman, the veteran pullers from Indiana that almost always get the job done, no matter where they go, with a two-wheel drive, a four-wheel drive, a tractor. It doesn't matter, Paul. These people are just born pullers.
Well, and added to the fact that they really know their way, they're sitting back in the lineup, so they've had a chance to watch everybody that have gone before, and as a result, they've been able to study the course and study the weight setups, and they can make some changes where the other people are really breaking new ground. So Heilman is up there and ready to go. This could be one terrific run.
And it is one totally professional team. John and Ann Heilman. And putting that expertise to work is Heilman behind that hand throttle. Here comes the weight transfer box on the sled. This is a nice one. Into the lead goes John Heilman. 268.68 feet. Fred Freeman gets finally bumped down to second. He'll still be happy with that.
Well, Heilman did what we predicted, and he certainly had an opportunity to study what everyone else had done. I think that worked to his advantage. Plus, they really know the setup on this machine. Look at those giant engines as they go to work. He had the wheel cocked just the way he wanted it to bring everything back a little bit in line because he came off the start a little askew. Finally, he gets it lined up. The power is right. The balance looks perfect.
And what Heilman does, as well as anybody else, is using the brakes, using his feet to dance on those individual rear brakes and help control the tractor. When the wheels are in the air, the steering wheel is of no help. That was a fine, fine effort.
So the new lead at 268.6 feet. That's got to have John Powell thinking about it. They've just fired the engine on his machine. John Powell will be out next. But we have a new benchmark here at 268.68 feet. That's set by John Heilman. Now they're making sure that everything here is fired up and ready to go for John Powell. At the same time, down at the far end, the Team Heilman group must be celebrating their new run. Let's go down to Pat Patterson.
Well, you had your work cut out for you, and you cut out a piece of it and did a good job.
Well, Fred Freeman put down some kind of run there early in the class, and I knew it was going to take an awful good shot. I'm not sure that's going to hold up. You got John Powell back there. He's been running tough. We're leading the points right now, and it's a good time to kick some tail, don't you know?
How much did you learn by watching these other tractors before you got your shot?
Oh, quite a bit. You had to be careful. The tractors got bent out of shape. They start rocking back and forth. We did a little bit. We moved 200 pounds of weight back there right at the last, and everything paid off again.
We'll see if it holds up.
Thank you.
All right, next and last to pull is John Powell and Team Powell. Now, this is a three-motor tractor, and we heard other competitors, especially Mike Piper, who has three engines, say that this combination is not competitive in the class. So let's see.
Now, their complaint was that they wouldn't get enough wheel speed out of the three engines. It would seem to me that you'd lose wheel speed the more engines you hang on there. We
171.9 feet. He edges out John Heilman and takes the win on the very last pull. John Powell wins the 7,200-pound tractor class.
And judging by the smoke pouring off that motor at the end, he really used every bit of power he could. Look at the blowpipe coming out the bottom. You know, maybe his tri-engine tractor setup works for him because the engine is pushed so far out, like the fourth engine in David Banner's tractor.
Hard to say, but there is the champion, John Powell.
Well, if you want to be a tractor puller, take a look at this run, because that's exactly what you want to do if you want to be successful. John Powell wins it. Now he's down at the far end with Pat Patterson.
Well, John, you guys really had a good show here tonight.
We really did. We thought we could do it. We're coming in here. We didn't get a real good start, but it worked out real good. We went to further.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Yeah, that was an awfully fine effort in a very, very competitive class. John Powell, 271.9. Heilman almost at it, 268.6. Fred Freeman, 254, better than he thought he'd do. Banner and Walsh round out the top five. And Paul, you know what these babies are rolling out of the tunnel from the parking lot.
It's a pretty one. Nightlife 2. The monster trucks, they're ready as second round continues.
Up, that tire doesn't really look all that big, does it?
But as the camera widens back,
you get an idea of the kind of rubber it takes to handle a monster truck. I'm Steve Evans, along with Paul Page and Pat Patterson. We're back in the Astrodome for the TNT Super Nationals. We're about to see Clydesdale go head-to-head with Nightline. Bennett Clark in the Clydesdale truck. We've seen him perform magnificently here in the Dome.
And no slouch as a driver either is this man, Dave Wysorek from Grand Island, Nebraska. His trademark is real smooth, Paul. Not long air jumps, but keeping it down low, trying to keep the wheels driving and hanging out the window like that so he can see where he's going.
As with any form of motorsport, smoothness is it. They start Clydesdale, sprays a little vapor as he gets started, but Clydesdale gets the hole shot. And look at Wysorek hang out of the window to try to figure out where he's going as Clydesdale already is into the turn and heading back. So Bennett Clark takes the lead here. Take a look at that jump of Clydesdale. Clydesdale comes across the line and picks up the win. Bennett Clark.
Boy, when that truck started to crab like that, Paul, I wondered if he was going to end up like a couple of other trucks being disqualified for crossing a boundary. Well, Bennett Clark covered the down portion of the course so much quicker than Nightlife 2 that he definitely had the advantage as he spun that truck around to take it on home.
Bennett Clark got it pointed in the right direction first and also had a little more power as they came off the jump. And as a result of that, it set up this situation. Coming to the cars, Bennett Clark got her up in the air, but with nice balance. But you can see he got a little over to the side and fell off. But still, the inertia was so good that Bennett Clark came across the line as the winner over Nightlife. Don't you love this? Bennett Clark, to get out, climbs out of the back window, hops onto a rear tire, and now Pat Patterson is there.
Well, Bennett gets his helmet off here. We'll find out exactly what kind of passes you saw. It looked like a pretty good run for you.
Yeah, it ran pretty good. I had the motor shut off with me on the first set of cars. I went down, had a pretty decent turn, a little oversteered. Coming back, I just tried to make front tires, make the first set of cars the way I needed to. And looked like I was a little bit ahead of it, so I just stayed in it just in case.
On to the next round. Good luck.
All right, thank you.
The race drivers are famous for putting on hats for television interviews, but I believe that one was a first, Paul Page.
Yeah, generally you want to make some bucks out of it. I don't know, unless he's got a cowboy hat sponsor, what good it did to slap that one on?
You know, cowboys just wear hats. That's how it is.
I guess that's it.
All right, here is the next pair of trucks. It will be this young man, John Kwasniewski, the Buffalo Trimmer, up against a guy you've seen a number of times in our coverage from the Astrodome, old John Moore, and no problem. Well, earlier in first-round competition up against this man, Ken DePee in Whiskey Business, there was a problem, all right, but it wasn't John's. Watch the truck on the left-hand side of your screen. Not only did he not make the turn, he darn near knocked down the Astrodome. Crunch. There was no injury to the driver or any spectators, anything like that, but a whole heck of a lot of injury to Whiskey Business.
Well, Ken, we always talk about how tough that turn is down there, but You like to took part of the Dad Blame Stadium now.
Yeah, I came off the cars and the throttle stuck wide open on it, and I tried to hit the kill and I couldn't reach it in time. The kill's off back to my side and I just couldn't get a hold of it. And I couldn't make the turn with it wide open like that, or I'd have rolled it. So.
Well, you're okay.
Yeah, I'm fine.
People don't realize how complicated it gets down there trying to make that turn. And when you start kind of reaching for levers and kill switches, that kind of thing can happen, and as it did.
Yeah, I feel real bad about it. You know, we got to get it fixed now again to race again next week. Hopefully, it's tore up pretty bad underneath.
Well, you thrilled him in the Astrodome, and we hope you can get that thing fixed.
We'll get it fixed.
Well, after Whiskey Business smacked the wall, John Moore and No Problem advanced here to the second rep. And Paul, he's not noted for great horsepower or quick times around the course. John Moore is noted for reliability, so the Buffalo Tremor can't make any mistakes here.
The Tremor fires it up on the far side. It is No Problem. No Problem with a slight lead. Buffalo Tremor got a little askew on the first jump. They come to the far end and make the turn. They hit the jump dead equal, both of them, with a clean turn at the far end. But Buffalo Tremor gets a little better course coming back, has the lead at the moment, hangs on to it, and the Buffalo Tremor takes the win. No Problem has a little bit of problem getting it stopped. Buffalo Tremor, the winner of this confrontation.
I tell you, Paul, this is the most horsepower for John Moore that we've ever seen in the left-hand lane there. He's gone to a bigger engine or more supercharger or something, and maybe that made it a little harder for him to drive. He actually got the truck onto that return jump first, but just kind of wandered off course like it had a mind of its own. And the beautiful Buffalo Tremor, a high-flying victory headed for the semifinals.
You wonder if inside that cockpit you go grabbing for all the levers and gadgets and everything. If you get bounced around, you just get totally discombobulated in there. And they had a little problem down at the far end as well. One of them had trouble getting stopped. There you take a look at why, because No Problem had that problem. Let's go to Pat Patterson.
John, is a pretty good pass for you.
Yeah, see, the truck seems to be running real good. The track's holding together good. It seems like we'd be doing all right.
Any changes for the next round?
No, we're not making no changes at all.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Yeah, if I had a truck running as good as that one is, I don't think I'd change a thing either. He's headed for the semifinals. And in the semis, we will be seeing the Buffalo Tremor up against the Equalizer. And, surprise, surprise, the other half of the semifinals will be Bigfoot versus Clydesdale. Bigfoot was disqualified, you say. After another look, and I think you'll agree with the decision, Awesome Kong, we know, hit that center cone. That was a clear-cut decision. You'll see it in just a second. If you watch on the left, Bigfoot said, oops, I could foul here, stopped, backed up, and legally completed the course. That's the ruling. Bigfoot is back into the semis. Got it?
Well, in the meantime, Steve, we're ready for some more tractor pulling. The 6,200-pound two-wheel drive class. We've already had a test pass. The sled was a little too light, so they're putting in some more weight.
All right, we're about to put some serious animation in the TNT Super Nationals truck and tractor pulls from the Astrodome. I'm talking about the two-wheel drive trucks, where the steering wheel, Paul Page, is virtually useless if you have the right kind of pull.
The full pull distance here is 325 feet. There's Ken Popham. Fast forward is the machine. He has his hands up to tell everybody working at the back of his vehicle that he's not touching the controls and it's safe to step behind the machine. Now on the decision maker is Ollie Schaefer. He's going to make sure that the weight transfers right, that it moves at the right speed. The two-wheel drives ready to go, 6,200 pounds.
And some beautiful equipment, trucks, cars, hot rods, all kinds of variety in the two-wheel class. Here goes Texan Ken Popham. Ooh. He's got the weight really messed up on the brake, Paul. That truck shouldn't be that high. You shouldn't be able to walk under it safely.
Yeah, no, he's got the front end weight set completely wrong. He's going to have to reevaluate that thinking the next time he goes pulling. Kenneth Popham, 270 feet, almost 30 feet short of a full pull, and I'm sure a disappointing run for the fast forward.
You know, when he first started off, it appeared that he just kind of eased into the throttle, and the weight looked just about right here, about a foot, foot and a half, but as it came up mid-course, oh boy. Oh, Ken, all I could see was the roof of the Astrodome. That's when he knew he'd guessed wrong.
Yeah, he kind of rotated up to V2 and ready for takeoff, and that just isn't going to work.
weight really needed to be further forward on this machine. Ken Popham, who normally does a pretty good job with it, but a disappointing 270 feet.
Ken, what did you think of that pass? They changed the weight on this sled. Do you think it was to your advantage here?
Well, I think it's all right. You know, it may be to my advantage. I don't know. I don't have any more weight to put on the front, so I can't change anything.
As far as your truck, though, you felt like you had a good balance on it?
Yeah, I think I had a good pass.
All right, let's see what happens.
All right, thank you.
Well, apparently Ken likes looking at the roof of the Astrodome.
Well, that really surprises me, especially considering some of the other competition that we have seen here. I think he would have wanted to be much closer to the 300-foot full pull in order to feel safe, but maybe know something that we don't. Let's watch the next competitor as he comes up. It's Rick Carpenter. Look at that pretty machine. It's the Sundance Kid.
Well, most people know things that we don't, Paul. Rick Carpenter is out of Bettenfort, Iowa, and you're right, it is an absolutely gorgeous machine. Now, these are supercharged vehicles, just about. In fact, all of them are. If Rick Carpenter, Paul, learned something watching Ken Popham, it would really be too late to implement it. He didn't have time to reweight anything. He might change his driving style just a little bit to try to minimize that front end lift. All right, now the power has been fully applied. Ooh, it's pretty. Real pretty.
Bounces a little bit. A little better weight control. 275 feet. Now that gets him further than Ken Popham, but maybe Popham was pretty bright about it. He realized that what he ran was pretty close to what the course could hold. Let's wait and see.
Well, Paul, I think Ken Popham had more power than Rick Carpenter because Rick Carpenter's engine started to expire towards the latter part of this pull. I mean, he had the balance, obviously, so much better, but he only netted 5 more feet than Popham. That could only be because he was down on power, not because he didn't have the throttle wide open. You can see by the butterflies and those great, 3 great big holes there that he did that. But whoo, here came what they call death smoke. And that only means that before that truck pulls again, that motor will come out and some very pricey parts will be installed.
Meantime, back at the starting line, Mark Hare fires up one of the prettiest machines. Nice black chrome glistening everywhere. It is the Jack Daniels. And he lowers the top on that. Hydraulic electrics. Look at that thing shine in the lights of the Astrodome. Let's go to the far end now, though, and talk to Rick Carpenter. He is with Pat Patterson. Pat?
Well, Rick, that was an expensive pass.
Yeah, I think so. I think the motor got a little lean on us there. Taking a lot of power on this track. I think we leaned it out, I can tell you.
Hate to see it in any kind of motorsports when you lose a motor. It's a tough night.
Yeah, you bet. Thanks a lot.
Boy, there is no joy in that camp. All right, our next puller, as you said, Paul, is Mark Hare in one of the prettiest two-wheel drive vehicles I have ever seen in TNT competition. It is just a masterpiece. All right, he's going to plug it into gear, grabs that throttle, about 1,500 horsepower potentially.
Ollie Schaefer at the controls of the sled as Mark Hare makes his run, and Jack Daniels, the front end comes up a bit, then levels out, balances nicely, but he begins drifting over to the side and finally digs it in.
And you can see the mountain of dirt that Mark has put between his truck and that sled, which makes the sled even more difficult to pull. 271.43 feet, and that will put him in second place just behind Rick Carpenter. Let's take one more look at the pull by Jack Daniels.
Well, as he comes off the line, the balance comes up just a little bit, but look at the rear wheels. He's getting a very nice bite there. If he can get the weight adjusted out right, he would have had a spectacular run here. As it was a good run, but still not good enough to end up in the top position.
I told you there was variety in this class. Look at this magnificent Ford Model T, or replica thereof, of Wayne Roush. Wayne is out of Columbus, Ohio, and is a retired college professor. Actually took early retirement to go tractor pulling.
The yellow Model T. Run in comes up, drives in a good position, weight rolling forward on the decision maker. Nice run. He's down in the competitive area, but he grinds to a stop just a little bit early, right on that white line. And here comes the reading, 269.5 feet. That'll put Roush in fourth place behind Ken Popham.
might have missed the gearing just a little bit there. Maybe not quite enough power. One or the other puts Wayne Rouse, as you said, back there in the four spot. Rip Carpenter leads it at 275, followed by Mark here at 271, Popham at 270, and Wayne Rouse at 269.
For more of the two-wheel drive trucks at the TNT Super Nationals from the Astrodome in Houston, Texas. I'm Paul Page with Steve Evans and Pat Patterson, and there is Jim Lyons in stitches. Now, the mark that he is shooting for is Rick Carpenter's 275-foot mark, and stitches is purely capable.
Just when you think you've seen the prettiest vehicle ever in the two-wheel drive class, another just masterpiece rolls out to pull. And here goes Jim Lyons. Oh, he got some early momentum going. He's got, oh, this is a beautiful pull. This is almost a perfect pull.
Well, when you're in this sport, you hate to see a guy like Lyons come up late in the order because he learned so much from everybody that went before, and he learned it here. 286.62 feet. We've got a new leader.
I think you're right. On this track, it has been an advantage to pull late. Often, it is not. It gets so torn up, there's no traction left. Oh, what a fine, fine drive. He's doing more in there than we can see with his hands and his feet. Just an absolutely perfect run for the new leader, who's with Pat.
Well, Jim, that's what you want to do. You want to come out here and you want to do your best and lead it, and you're leading it.
We did, but we messed up there. We had to get on a break. The motor was real fast. I made a good run, a super run for where we're at. So if I don't win it, I just, you know, somebody's going to make all of a good pull.
How happy were you with where you decided to start off on the track?
Super. That's where I wanted it. It turned out great.
Jim Lyons is happy, but Ken Lamont, the Midnight Express, is up and ready to run next. Now, on one hand, horsepower is very important, but how you get that traction to the ground is equally important. You do that with tires. And earlier, Steve took a look.
Not long ago, everyone in the pulling sport ran agricultural tires off a combine or a tractor. That's all there was. Now, there's a company out in California called CPEC who builds a purpose-built tire for two-wheel drive and four-wheel drive. And here's one of those. You can see what they call lugs here. These ridges, that is the stock-designed CPEC tire. Now, one competitor, Ken Lamont, has decided to take them, well, a stage further. Here's another CPEC tire that Ken has had modified. Look at this. Double the number of lugs. It cost about $1,500 just to do the two tires. Now, there's no such thing as practice in this sport, so he doesn't really know if this is going to work until he hooks to the sled. Now, he thinks it'll get more traction because of all the lugs, but it may move so much dirt off the track and in front of the sled, it could make the sled harder to pull. Counterproductive.
Well, we're about to find out because the Midnight Express is taking its final safety wire hook, and Ken Lamont is ready. You can see there those brand new tires that Steve mentioned mounted on there. Distance to beat at 286 feet. Lamont's capable.
You know, this sport looks so elementary. How hard can it be? And there's so many nuances in it. All right, those new tires are maybe getting a little too much grip, or he's light on the front end. Because he is airborne most of the way and comes up disappointingly short at 267.66 feet. In fact, he's been disqualified. It wouldn't matter how far he pulled for crossing the boundary.
Well, Steve, I think you suggested there was the possibility of the tires with that much grip being counterproductive. I think that's exactly what we're going to see. Now, watch in front of that plate at the head of the decision-maker sled. Look at the mound of dirt that is already up there. That's all coming off those tires. And additionally, with so much grip, he couldn't get the balance that he wanted. So he was adding weight, while at the same time he wasn't balancing. It didn't work out very well at all.
Well, you know, the tires might still be okay if he gets the weight set. Otherwise, it's $1,500 down the drain.
You spend that kind of money. I don't think I'd be throwing them away too quick. I might do a little experimentation for a couple of weeks. Well, here's the rundown. Jim Lyons moves ahead of Rick Carpenter. The pull to beat now is 286.6 feet. Mark Hare is third. Ken Popham is fourth.
Well, here's proof positive. You can't keep a good truck down, even if momentarily you disqualify it. Bigfoot rolling out for the semifinals.
We're back at
the Houston Astrodome. You're looking at Bigfoot. We're ready for the semifinals in the Monster Trucks. And facing Bigfoot, driven by Andy Brass, will be the Clydesdale. Sitting there with Bennett Clark on board in the near lane. Bigfoot and Clydesdale. This should be a whale of a matchup.
And an even start, Paul. An experienced engine for his driving would have to go to Bennett Clark. But look at Andy Brass go in the butt. And he made his turn a little bit later than on the run that almost disqualified him. And, oh, Bigfoot 7 has to correct. The new suspension might have been helpful there. It is Bigfoot over a charging Clydesdale.
Clydesdale tried to play catch-up to Bigfoot. Almost got it done, but the finish line was just a little too far away. Here they are, dead even at the far end. But Bigfoot makes a spectacular turn. Not bad for Bennett Clark either. He was really using that four-wheel steer.
And you know, it's like no problem. At the same point, Bigfoot just veered off course for no reason. The wheels, I don't know what the problem is, but he corrected. Andy Brass did, got lined up just in time to take those crush cars with the proper line. And of course, Bob Chandler, the owner of Bigfoot, always gives his drivers maybe a little more power than anybody else.
Well, and that new suspension, I'm sure, helped when he found that he was out of line to get a better correction. And look how neatly Bigfoot lands. Now let's go down. Pat Patterson is waiting for Andy Brass to climb out the window of the Bigfoot. Pat?
Out of this show altogether, and now you're back into it and headed to the finals. What a night for you and Bigfoot.
This is, you know, it wasn't the way we really would like to do it. You know, the last run was a little controversy. We got disqualified, but we come back, made a legal run after we backed up. So it's TNT's been really preaching it to us that if you do get disqualified, back up and make a legal run, because you never know if the other guy is going to make a legal run or be DQ'd too.
Looked like when you made the turn down there, you almost lost a little bit of power before you made the second jump on the cars. Did you have any problems at all?
Hey, I'm having a little problem right now negotiating the corner. I got down there the first time, cut a little short, and I cut a little wide, so I'm hoping I can be right on this next round.
They're loving Bigfoot in the Astrodome tonight.
Well, thank you.
Well, you know, Paul, you may have noticed, not only to drive Bigfoot, do you have to be brave and clever, you have to be a contortionist to get in and out of the thing.
Oh, look at that.
I'll tell you.
Pulled up like a suitcase.
You know, and that was a nice comment, too. It showed professionalism, because a pro will always do that. You never know if there's some slight chance of an opportunity. Andy Brass, by backing up and running a legal run, well, it paid off for him. It brought him here to a victory in the semifinal round. We're ready with the next pair of the semifinals. There is Equalizer, David Morris on board. And, of course, he'll be facing this machine. That is the Buffalo Tremor, and it's driven by John Kwasniewski.
John Kwasniewski did a fantastic job to get to the semifinals here with a truck that we had not seen before, the Astrodome or anywhere else, and it is a beautiful piece of equipment.
Equalizer far side, Tremor over here on the near side. Both trucks are ready. Revs come up, there they go. Equalizer got a little quicker jump, and it paid off on the first straightaway as Equalizer gets to the corner first. Here he comes. Here comes Tremor around, cutting the corner a little bit quicker, but it's still Equalizer. Equalizer running the second set of cars. Equalizer comes across there. I think something's wrong on Tremor as Equalizer takes the win.
And, Paul, the disqualification flag is up one more time, but it really doesn't have any bearing on the outcome of the race, because it was Buffalo Tremor in the near lane who was disqualified. But, you know, on the down leg of the course, Equalizer looked like maybe he broke the front suspension. Oh, absolutely. It is trash. And there is where Buffalo Tremor committed his unpardonable sin of knocking that cone over. And I'm surprised that Equalizer continued to run. Of course, he didn't know the other truck was disqualified, but he knew the suspension was bad, and he did this. Ugh. That is bone-jarring to truck and driver. And me, for that matter. That hurt just watching it.
Got my teeth hurting there. I'll tell you, there appears to be some serious damage there to the Equalizer. They're going to have their work cut out for them if they're going to be ready for the final round. Let's go down. Pat is with Dave Morris.
Well, David, it looks like you've broken a rear wheel off now. That's going to be tough to get back in here.
We won't be back tonight. Unfortunately, we broke a spindle on the left rear tire, and there's no way we can come back.
What a tough break. You were going to the finals with Bigfoot tonight, and now to have this happen, I know it's awfully disheartening to you.
Yeah, it's really bad, because each and every run tonight here, I've been getting better on my turn down there, and I was really getting ready to put Bigfoot away in the finals.
Tough to see it. We're glad you're here.
Thanks.
Well, when David starts looking at truck over, he may find more than just a broken rear spindle. It hit so hard, David, I would check the setting in your high school ring. It may be on the floorboard somewhere.
Yeah, he's got a lot of looking. Now, that sets up an interesting situation. Who will run against Bigfoot? It's supposed to be Equalizer, but Dave said, ah, we're done. You're not coming back. So it's going to be the Clydesdale. That'll be the final round of Monster Trucks at the Houston Astrodome here in the TNT Super Nationals. But coming up next, the two-wheel drive class as the pull continues. Boy, is this machine beautiful. Jim Brockman in the Illaws and Outlaws is ready.
DNN.
Well, I don't know how she does it because it is noisy here in the Houston Astrodome. And we've seen some great action. There is more to come because we're ready to continue. Oh, we woke you up. We're sorry. I think she's the only one sleeping, though. We're ready to continue with the two-wheel drive trucks. Jim Brockman, Inlaws and Outlaws, brings her back. Look at this incredible machine. Earlier, Steve Evans took a nice close look.
Jim Brockman and the Inlaws and Outlaws team have always enjoyed creating truly unique machinery in the two-wheel drive truck class. Well, fans, they have outdone themselves with this replica, sort of a 1908 Chevrolet C-Cab delivery truck. And it got its name from the C-shape in the roof here. This is all hand-formed aluminum, riveted together. Every seam is perfect. Every compound curve, there is not a ripple anywhere. It's just a work of art. Now, you may ask, what are these three anodized levers here in the cockpit? Well, they're all connected to a specially built five-speed transmission. Now, Jim doesn't shift as he's executing the pull. It gives him five speeds to select from, depending on the weight he's pulling and the track condition. It stays in whatever gear he picks, and this is where he applies the power. Now, I think the older folks are going to love this. It's such a nostalgic design. But even the young folks, even the little kids, are going to get a kick out of seeing something that looks so unique on the floor of the Astrodome. Now, their grandparents or great-grandparents may have to explain to them what that is. That's the original 1908 Motometer temperature gauge for the radiator. It's now where you pour the fuel into this beauty.
Well, Steve, I really appreciate that being explained to us young people. Thank you very much. Jim Brockman, Inlaws and Outlaws, magnificent machine. It's beautiful, and it's ready to run. Jim Brockman is a legend in this plant. And here you see why. Look at that baby move down the pulling court. Jim Brockman has taken the lead, and the fans just love it. 295.53 feet. Darn near a full pull.
I don't have to say, he is the new leader.
Real close to the full pull. Tell you what, it looks like he didn't have quite the inflation in the rears that some of the others have used on their tire setting. He has the balance perfect. I think that gear system that you showed us, Steve, probably worked out because he could watch everybody before and select the right levers, and off he went.
Oh, and the front end weight, he hit perfectly. When he needed the transfer the most, he got it. Otherwise, they were just kind of 2, 3, 4 inches off the ground. That is just, well, that's a textbook drive.
Pretty machine, pretty pull from Jim Brockman. There he is climbing out, 295 feet. It was good, and he knows it. At the starting line, it's the Mad Dog, Mike Stowe.
You know, Paul, I love all of the highly crafted machines like the one we just saw set down a new standard. This thing is the closest to a stock kind of pickup truck. The interior is fairly stock. It's mostly a steel body, and so it's interesting in its own right.
No, it's the current series points leader, a man to watch, especially coming up this late. And look at the run. He's got it balanced right on the money. He's way, way down there.
That's a full pull for Mad Dog.
All right. Mike Stowe, he turns around and looks back. He knows that was a terrific run. He probably knew it every inch of the way because he had that thing balanced and running perfectly.
Beautiful Ford truck. Certainly did the job for Mike. And I think Mike went to school on all the other pullers. He had a bunch of them he could watch. And probably at the last second, Paul decided where to put that truck and what gear to run it in. Oh, that was, well, that maybe was the effort of the entire day.
Interesting that that kind of pull comes from one of the least exotic-looking machines
here at the Astrodome. Nice, nice run. Well, John Heilman, the Golden Thunder, you saw John a little bit earlier. He's come over to this class now after finishing second in the 7,200-pound tractor class. Let's go up to Pat Patterson now, who has Mike Stowe.
Tell me about that pass. It seemed like you just had it from start to finish.
Yeah, the truck really hooked good out of the hole. When I called on it, it just felt like it just leaped and glued to the ground, and when the front end picked up about 200 feet, it was all over in. It was cooking. I could have went through the wall.
Oh, that's the points. You're the points leader coming into this one, so I know this meant a lot to you.
Yeah, it does. It really means a lot. Houston's a great place to pull. We always enjoy it here.
We've got a cameraman down there at the far end that's darn glad Mad Dog didn't go on through the wall, because he was between the wall and Mad Dog. The Golden Thunder. Boy, what a pretty machine. They are all gorgeous in this class. That's John Heilman. Almost looks like a funny car, doesn't it, Steve?
Well, in many ways it is, Paul. The same kind of body construction, all fiberglass, a replica of a 1990 Thunderbird. I guess it's the name Golden Thunder. Oh, boy. Heilman, we told you before, he is just a consummate pro. But the pro is not that consummate on this pole, because the front end is way too high. You just can't fly a plane like that. And John will not challenge for the lead on that pole.
Well, he took it all the way down to the end, but way over to the side. Not nearly the full pole that we saw a few moments ago, but still a spectacular run. If he'd only had it straight and under control, I think he might have been there with a full pole as well. 312 and a half feet.
312 feet with the front end that high? Oh, boy, that says a lot for the driver behind the wheel. John Heilman, he knew right here, I better do something quick. He didn't want to back out of the throttle. In fact, we looked. No, he did not. He just hoped it would settle down, and for a moment it looked like it might.
Can you imagine how gentle you have to be with that much horsepower to make those little adjustments? Now, John Heilman is at the finish line with Pat Patterson.
Well, John Heilman, looked like you were hooked up pretty good there. You got any major complaints with that pass?
Oh, I'd like to have a little more weight on the front. We got this new setup this year, new motor, new chassis setup, and we're still trying to get the bugs out of it. It was a little light on the front, and everything worked fine. Good run. Thank you.
I don't want to be around when they get the bugs sorted out of that. If that pulls that kind of run without the bugs sorted out, Steve, it's going to be a spectacular machine when he gets it going.
No, that statement was not good for the competition. Our next puller getting ready. This is Liege McLean in a truck they call Rowdy.
They bring the Rowdy up into place. The red flag says, wait, hold on, don't do it. We're not ready to go just yet. Full pull, 325 feet is the distance to beat. They pull up the tension on the chain, and Lees is on his way.
Now, the balance is maybe a little nose heavy, Paul.
Yes, sir, absolutely. Just a bit heavy on the nose, maybe a taste down on power, but I'll tell you what, that truck is so pretty. I'd watch it told them if it only went 3 feet.
Still a pretty good run, 290.86 feet for Liege McLean in the Rowdy.
Of course, the full pull of Mike Stowe is still the top run here in the Houston Astrodome.
You know, it appeared to be a little bit nose-heavy, but suddenly at the far end it leaped forward, and that's kind of a conflict in terms. But he didn't get the weight transfer he needed early on. We're about mid-course. Down here it was almost too late because the box was transferring so rapidly, it was about to grind into a hole anyway.
So much horsepower, and yet such a delicate balance. Well, this is our last puller, Richard Wisson. The machine is hot shot. Now, he's the only puller now capable of forcing a pull-off with Mike Stowe. Mike Stowe, of course, has a full pull at 325 feet.
The slack out of the chain. The truck is from Alabama. And this is a blast-ditch effort for Richard Wishnet. Now, if you could learn from watching the fellow competitor, this man ought to be a professor on this course tonight.
Well, he certainly had an opportunity to see everybody that went before. He knows exactly what lane on the course to set his machine in. He's off. The hot shot is pouring the power to it. Front end is flying in a pretty good place. He's looking awfully good on this run. Ah, but his front end comes up. Balance changes. And the balance transfers not nearly far enough. 299.4 feet. So Mike Stowe with the full pull picks up the win.
Absolutely. And that's the way a class ought to be. One good full pull. That's just all in all good action around. What a terrific class this is, and you can tell after watching it why it's one of the fans' favorites. Mike Stope, he's the champ at the TNT Super Nationals. John Heilman, over 312 feet. That should have won it in most cases, but not tonight. Let's go down to the far end with Pat.
A lot of fans around the country have never seen anything like this in the Astrodome, and a lot of pullers around the country never run here in the Astrodome. It really is special.
Well, it's a heck of a show. It's the best motorsport show the dollar for the spectator can buy. I mean, you can't see this for the price of this admission anywhere in the world.
A little celebrating tonight?
You better believe it.
Congratulations.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Mike Stowe, the winner, two-wheel drive, 6,200-pound class with a 325-foot full pull. Now, who's going to join Mike Stowe's party? The winner of the monster trucks. And who will that be? We're about to find out. Not only has no one left the Astrodome, the personnel and the snack bars and the souvenir stands have also found a seat for the Monster Truck Final. Anytime Bigfoot is involved, Paul, well, it gets everybody's attention. The truck is just such a legend. It's the foundation of this sport. And look at Andy Brasco. He has got Bennett Clark and Clydesdale off the line. And I have to believe the new suspension on that truck is making it possible for Andy to do things like he just did. Make a smooth, attractive turn. Oh, but what a turn for Bennett Clark as he's trying to catch the Bigfoot. But down on the last jump, it didn't work for him. Bennett Clark comes in second, the winner, Andy Brass in the Bigfoot. This may be our most interesting replay in monster truck competition. There you can see how ably Bennett Clark uses the four-wheel steering capability of that Clydesdale truck. Now watch Bigfoot over the far side, up the jump. He never even touches the cars. Incredible.
I'll tell you what, though, Bennett Clark made that corner like he was driving a Ferrari. Still, that superior suspension of the Bigfoot made the difference here in the Astrodome. Let's go down to Pat Patterson.
Andy, what a great show you two put on in this final at the Astrodome.
Yes, it was. I think it was going to be a good show tonight. You know, like I say, I don't think it come down like a lot of us wanted, but it come down.
Tell me about that last pass. You were wide open from the get-go and came all the way back through the same way.
That's right. You know, I've been dogging a little bit on the first couple passes, and I thought, well, I got down here to the finals, and I made a good corner. Just going to make a nice, slow corner, get straightened up, and just hammer on it.
I know you love to win, especially at a place like the Astrodome.
Yes, it does. Just feel good, you know, here with all the Houston fans. I know they're all Ford fans and are all behind us.
Great night for you.
Thank you.
A masterful drive of a perfectly crafted vehicle as Bigfoot now touches the cars because they parked it there. That's the winner's circle. Bob Chandler, the owner, builder of the truck, off to the side. And what a reprieve Bigfoot got tonight. Almost disqualified in the second round. Let's go to Pat with second place.
The minute you told us you were going to get him and you came up just a hair short. You guys, what a final here in the Astrodome.
Well, I ran a truck just as hard as it could possibly go. I think he may have a little bit of horsepower on me. I come down, I made the turn just as perfect a turn as I could probably make at that speed. Looking at the video, it looked like I was bouncing off the ground. I couldn't have turned it much harder. I think it went on over.
Now, this is what nights are made of, though, when you can come in, make it to the finals, and put on a good show for the crowd. I know that's what you wanted to do.
Yeah, that's what I want to do. One of these days, I'm going to get Bigfoot the next time.
All right, gentlemen, you heard it from second place winner.
Bigfoot is like that gunfighter. The new kids on the block all want him. We had a wonderful time tonight in the Astrodome, and so did Andy Brass as he won the Monster Truck Competition. John Powell, the 7,200-pound tractors, and Mike Stowe was the full pull of the 6,200-pound two-wheel drive class. For Paul Page and Pat Patterson, I'm Steve Evans saying so long from the Astrodome.
The executive producer for American Sports Cavalcade is Harvey M. Palish. Supervising producer, John B. Mullen. Produced and directed by Mark Guchin. A promotional consideration provided for and a fee paid by this special offer from Diamond B.
For seven seasons, Diamond P Sports award-winning American Sports Cavalcade series on TNN has brought you a wider variety of motorsports than any other, and with more cameras than you normally see. And it's because of the talented people who man these viewfinders, Diamond B has been able to produce an exciting new video entitled, And They Walked Away. Incredible crash from stock car racing, motocross, IMSA and SCCA road racing, NHRA drag racing, Eastern modified, even swamp buggies, and more. To get your copy of And They Walked Away, send $24.95 plus $3.50 shipping and handling to the address on your screen. Or better yet, call 1-800-453-9300. Visa and MasterCard accepted, no CODs. Call now, 1-800-453-9300.
The American Sports Cavalcade is a presentation of Diamond B Sports.